Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the third meeting of the Rural Affairs, Islands and Natural Environment Committee in session six. Before we begin, can I remind all members to turn any electronic devices to silent. Our first item of business excuse me, is to take evidence from the Cabinet Secretary for Rural Affairs and Islands on her priorities within the remit for session six. I welcome Marie Goujon, Cabinet Secretary, and our supporting officers. I'd like to put on record our disappointment that you're not with us in person, Cabinet Secretary, given the explicit desire of the committee that Cabinet Secretaries and Ministers appear in person. So it is disappointing, given the nature of this session, that you're not with us today. I just want to put that on record, and hopefully in the future we can accommodate you and your officials in the committee rooms in front of us. So I welcome the Cabinet Secretary, and with her, George Burgess, the Deputy Director of Food and Drink, John Kerr, Head of Agriculture Policy Division, and Carol Cowan, Deputy Director, Funding and Strategy for Marine Scotland. And I'd like to invite the Cabinet Secretary to make an opening statement, and then we'll go to questions. Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Convener, and I'm just sorry that I can't be with you today. And thank you very much, though, for inviting me to give evidence to the committee. And I'm sure it won't be my last appearance, and I'm delighted to set out the Scottish Government's stall and our priorities for rural affairs and islands over the course of this parliamentary session. First of all, I'm proud and feel really humbled to have been asked by the First Minister to lead on this important portfolio, because there are exciting times ahead. There are huge challenges, but there are also significant opportunities too. I have the honour of leading one of this government's single biggest areas of reform and revitalisation over the course of the next 4 years, while also aligning key rural sectors with wider national priorities. Convener, I'm determined for Scotland's rural and island areas and industries to play their part in contributing to our net zero ambitions and in enhancing biodiversity. But I also want rural and island economies and communities to benefit from these priorities too, for there to be more inclusive growth, for green skills to create career opportunities, and for Fair Work First principles to be applied. I want Scotland to realise the undoubted immense potential that rural Scotland has, and to create sustainability for these areas in that process. And key to that is enabling and empowering communities to be in charge of their own destinies, contributing their knowledge, skills, and turning ideas into action. I want to see communities in charge of the changes they want to see locally across rural Scotland. And that's why I'm pleased to announce today the launch of the Rural Communities Ideas into Action Fund that will open for applications of up to £50,000 from not-for-profit community groups from the 13th of this of September. Now, through that, we'll be looking for projects that demonstrate that they advance greater inclusion, equality and diversity in local communities. Projects will also need to show how they'll support other priorities such as net zero ambitions and be community-led. And when it comes to what else we'll be reforming and revitalising in the coming year, work is already underway to create a new system of rural support. The newly formed Agriculture Reform Implementation Oversight Board, which I will co-chair with Martin Kennedy, the President of the NFUS, meets for the first time on Monday. By November, the board will have agreed a national test programme, and we will have started to recruit farmers and crofters to take part in that programme. The board's core premise is to take forward the recommendations of the farmer-led groups as set out in our manifesto. We also will consult on a new agriculture bill, setting out our vision for this new rural support system, while also ensuring our future policy stays broadly aligned with the EU. We'll continue to modernise tenant farming, as well as modernising small landholding legislation, and we'll also seek to double the amount of land used for organic farming by 2026. And as part of the wider reform agenda, we'll start work to determine how best to support new and young entrants into farming. And by the end of this Parliament, we will have doubled annual support for women in agriculture to develop their skills. Now, I'm also determined to ensure that we maintain the highest possible welfare standards for all animals. We'll work in partnership with other administrations across these islands where that's in everyone's best interest to do so, while also meeting Scotland's specific interests. So we'll review animal welfare legislation to improve animal transport legislation, and we'll also act to lead on improving measures too. Work will begin to phase out cage-laying hens and farrowing crates for pigs, and to review the current honeybee health strategy. We also need the right mix of professionals to care for our animals, and that's why we'll progress the commitment to create a new Scottish veterinary service. The provision of vets and other animal health professionals right across farming, as well as in our food and drink industry, is one of the areas where Brexit has had a negative impact and shown how vulnerable we are in terms of having the right people with the right skills in the right places. And that's why we're undertaking a root and branch review of land-based education with an independent commission already appointed. But the fact remains that no matter what we do to reform or to revitalise to create a fairer and greener rural Scotland, our efforts will be hindered by the UK government's reckless decision to pursue a hard Brexit during the pandemic. Now, we warned of the consequences, and these are now being experienced due to the loss of freedom of movement and free trade. And worse than that, the UK government is intent on shortchanging us in Scotland yet again by failing to replace lost EU funding in full, which is the latest in the litany of broken Brexit promises. And time and again, our interests have been ignored. But throughout it all, and throughout all that, rural industries and the people who work in them have shown their resilience, innovation, creativity and entrepreneurship. And I don't think that's more evident anywhere than in our vibrant food and drink sector. As we celebrate Scotland Food and Drink Fortnight, we will also begin a series of actions to provide the sector with more support to help it grow and to help it grow sustainably. We'll introduce a new Good Food Nation Bill and reinstate the Ministerial Working Group on Food. We're consulting on a draft local food strategy and working closely with industry and stakeholders in delivering the food and drink sector recovery plan. On seafood, by the end of the year, we'll set out our new blue economy vision, recognising the interconnections between social, economic and environmental incomes when managing our marine assets. We'll publish a new strategy for seafood next year and continue to support an aquaculture industry that's sustainable, diverse, competitive and economically viable. The independent review of fish farming regulation is already underway and we'll act on its recommendations by the end of the year. In 2022, we'll lead in developing a new vision for aquaculture. We'll take forward the future fisheries management strategy, publishing a future catching policy and rolling out remote electronic monitoring to key parts of the fishing fleet. Convener, I'm also particularly pleased to have been appointed the Cabinet Secretary for Scotland's Islands. We have a range of ambitious and novel policies that we want to take forward, taking on board what island authorities and communities tell us that they need to thrive and flourish. We'll introduce a new £5 million islands bond fund, providing up to £50,000 each for up to 100 households by 2026, supporting a sustainable demographic future. And additionally, we'll invest £30 million of infrastructure investment plan capital funding over the next 5 years to ensure delivery of the National Islands Plan by supporting a range of areas, including tourism, infrastructure, innovation, energy transition and skills, informed by our learning of how island communities have responded and adapted to COVID-19. And we'll also deliver at least 3 carbon neutral islands by 2040, which will create jobs, protect our island environments from climate change, and will contribute to our 2045 net zero commitment. Our commitments to reform and revitalise rural affairs and island priorities are bold and ambitious. I'm clearly going to be busy over the coming session, but I also want to extend an offer in the spirit of the new cooperation agreement with the Scottish Greens to work with this committee in particular to take forward our programme for government and manifesto commitments. I know that many of you live in rural areas, have islands in your constituencies, and know a lot of these issues as well as, if not better than me, so it doesn't make sense to ignore that knowledge and experience. And I'm sure too that we all share a common aim and purpose, which is ultimately to make life in Scotland better for us all. And I would welcome the opportunity to work with you over the course of the parliamentary term to help achieve that for Scotland's rural and island communities. So thank you, and I look forward to your questions and to the discussion today.
Thank you for your opening statement, Cabinet Secretary. It's clear your remit is the Scottish Food Agency, agriculture, fisheries, aquaculture, animal welfare and crofting. However, there are significant overlaps in the portfolios that we see Cabinet Secretaries hold. And there's an overlap, particularly with the Cabinet Secretary for Net Zero. We had a session last week on food and drink supply chain, where there was a potential overlap with the Economy Committee. Can you let us know how you intend to deal with these overlaps, and how closely will you be working with the Cabinet Secretary for Net Zero, particularly when it comes to issues like biodiversity and land reform?
I will, of course, be working closely with my colleagues right across Cabinet, as well as with junior ministerial colleagues too. As you mentioned there, there are quite a lot of areas of overlap when you look at our marine environment, as well as our terrestrial environment too, when it comes to land use, when it comes to biodiversity. So, of course, I will have close working relationships, and I work closely with ministers and other Cabinet colleagues already in relation to those overlapping issues. In previous roles that I've had in government, I worked between two Cabinet Secretaries. There was, of course, a lot of overlap there. That was a relationship that worked, and it makes sense for us all to work together in meeting the really historic and demanding targets when it comes to emission reductions and climate change that we have. So that close working has been going on, and that will continue.
Thanks. Specifically, with some bills that are coming up, can you give us some more details about the Fox Control Bill and where that might sit, given, again, the potential overlap between this committee dealing with animal welfare and the net zero with land and forestry? And also some details on the likely time scales for the Good Food Nation Bill coming forward.
Yes, in relation to the Fox Control Bill that will be led by the Minister for Environment and Land Reform, Mary McCallan, and in relation to the timescales for the Good Food Nation Bill, that's in the programme for government, and we will be introducing that shortly.
Okay, just that raises a question. So Mary McCallan is going to be the lead minister. Is that bill likely to come to our committee or to the Cabinet Secretary that she chances to in net zero?
You mean in relation to the committee consideration of the bill?
Yes.
I mean, I believe that may well fall to the remit of the Rural Affairs, Islands and Natural Environment Committee, but I think when it comes to the committee allocation of bills and pieces of legislation, that will ultimately be up to the Bureau to determine.
Okay, thank you. I'm now going to move on to some questions on agriculture, and I'll move to Jim for the first question.
Thank you very much, Convener, and thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary, for attending. I've got a couple of questions here I'd like to go over with you. First of all, you gave a broad outline of what the new agricultural bill that you're bringing forward for agricultural subsidy is about. What do you hope to achieve? What is its purpose, specifically relating to food production? And can I add to that, what will the conditionality on support look like in terms of the balance between environmental and food production? What's the balance going to be, or do you have any idea what the balance is going to be between the two? But I really want to know what it is that you're trying to achieve with the bill that you're bringing forward for the new agricultural subsidy system.
Thank you for those questions. I mean, in relation to the new agriculture bill and what we're hoping to achieve with that, ultimately we support active farming. We'll be supporting the continuation of direct payments. And what's critical within that is that we continue to support food production. But we've also committed that in our manifesto that we would be shifting half of all funding for farming and crofting to conditional support by 2025. So that would be seeing farmers and crofters rewarded for their role in delivering wider biodiversity and environmental benefits. Now, when it comes to conditionality and what that might look like, this was something that was considered by the farmer-led groups, and they considered what that might look like for each of the different sectors. But I think what is clear from all of that, I mean, I think there were different suggestions within that as well as to what that might look like. But I think what will be clear from, and what's been clear from all that work, is that conditionality would mean reducing greenhouse gas emissions to the lowest possible level for every business, as well as restoring and protecting biodiversity for our farm landscapes. And those two objectives go hand in hand. But also a critical element of us developing our proposals for that bill is making sure that that's co-developed and co-produced. We want to make sure that we bring farmers and industry along with us throughout that process, which is why we established the Agriculture Reform Implementation and Oversight Board, so that we can test proposals and ensure that we're working hand in hand when it comes to developing new policy. And because we hope that in doing that, that means that the new policy will be a success.
Okay, you've said that it's going to be a sort of 50-50 on environmental and on food production. Now, my understanding is that that differs radically from the UK Agricultural Act that has been passed. And does that then put us in a collision course with the UK government in terms of the UK Internal Market Act if we have a different agricultural policy for here in Scotland?
Yes, this will be different to what's being pursued across the rest of the UK and from England in particular, where they will be removing and phasing out direct payments and looking at a more outcomes-based approach. And I think that's where we could start to see issues. I think when we look at what's happening with in relation to the Internal Market Act, subsidy control as well, and what's being brought into replace state aid, that is a big concern for us. We're not 100% clear yet how that will impact on our ability to take a different policy course than what's been pursued elsewhere. I mean, when it comes to subsidy control, we'd specifically asked that agriculture wasn't included within that. We had the results of the consultation shared with us in relation to that, because that could well constrain us in ways that we're not 100% clear yet on how that could or what the full impacts of that would be. But in the meantime, it's important for us to set our own agriculture policy for Scotland. We have a very different land type to the rest of the UK, and that's why it's important that we have the ability to set our own policy and set a framework for payments that works for farmers and land managers here in Scotland.
So from that, it's clear that we need to keep a very close eye on on where the divergence is going to be and where it could bring us into conflict with the UK government as the policy is developed. Would that be fair to say?
Oh, absolutely, because like I say, between the Internal Market Act and what's being proposed in relation to the subsidy control, that's where we have to be very careful and keep a close eye on how that develops. And we continue to try to engage with the UK government when it comes to these issues to ensure that our interests are represented and that we have the ability to create our own policy here. But it's, again, that can be very difficult when you're not provided with all the information that you need.
Okay, I'm aware that I'm taking up a lot of time, Convener. I've got two very quick questions for you, Cabinet Secretary. The NFU have written to Kevin Foster asking for a 12-month COVID recovery visa. First of all, do you know if they've had any response? Have you had any communication with them in order to get that put in place? And the second thing I wanted to ask you, but I've only just learned about, is something in the new programme for government, is that you're looking at the living wage for agricultural workers. Well, we already have the Agricultural Wages Order in Scotland, which takes agricultural wages well above the minimum wage. Now, I don't know where the balance is. Are you telling us that the Agricultural Wages Order will be scrapped, or is there something else that we don't know about at this stage?
No, we're not saying that the order would be scrapped, and we'd very much be working with the Agricultural Wages Board to try and reach that goal where wages are below the living wage. And sorry, just to come back to your previous point, was that in relation to
the request
from the NFUS, to the UK government about
Yes, they wrote to Kevin Foster, who's the Under Secretary for Future Borders and Immigration, asking for a 12-month COVID visa in order to get over the short-term supply chain of workforce in the agricultural sector. Do you know if that has been granted, and have you had any communication with the UK government on that?
As far as I'm aware, I don't believe there has been a response to that, and I personally haven't had any communications from the UK government in relation to this. But of course, this is an issue that we've continued to pursue with the UK government, because as the committee will be aware, this is absolutely critical now in terms of our food production, and it's right across the supply chain. I know that the committee took evidence on this last week, and we'd also it was raised countless times throughout the debate that we had on food and drink last week too. There have been asks of the UK government in relation to the shortage occupation list, some of the requests that you've mentioned there, Mr. Fairley, and we of course support that. And unfortunately, the levers to to try and influence any of that aren't within our control. So on the back of the letters that were issued by industry and by NFUS last week, I've also written to the UK government to request a call with the Home Secretary to discuss the critical issues that we're facing here in Scotland now, in the hope that they'll listen to us. But I mean, as I also outlined in the debate last week, we've had 19 different approaches to discuss migration with the UK government, and so far every single one of them has been ignored.
So I presume that you will bring us up to date if there is any progress in any of those issues.
I'd be happy to keep the committee up to date.
Thank you.
Thank you. Just before a short supplement from Rachel, you suggested that you've contacted the UK government 19 times without response. Could you tell us how many times your civil servants have met with the equivalent civil servants in Westminster over the last month? How many meetings have been held?
I wouldn't be able to tell you that off of the top of my head, convener, but I'd be happy to get back to the committee with that further information.
Yeah, that would be useful. Could I now move on to Rachel and then Alistair? Thank you.
Thanks, and thank you, Cabinet Secretary, for this morning. In the programme for government, it says that you'll bring forward a preliminary package of measures to reduce greenhouse gas emissions from agriculture developed by COP26. That's actually a very tight timeframe. My question, supplementary, is twofold on this. Is with regards to gene editing, it wasn't mentioned in the programme for government. And if you're going to go have close alignment with the EU, that means that you're almost shutting the door to innovation to ensure that you do reduce emissions. Do you have any plans that you can share with the committee on that?
I don't have any particular plans on that at the moment that I can share with the committee. We're aware of the discussions that are happening within the EU on this at the moment, and that is, of course, an area that we're monitoring closely. But, of course, as there are developments in that area, I'd be happy to update the committee on that.
OK, thank you. Alistair.
Thank you very much, convener. I have a few questions that are all, you won't be too surprised to hear, island-related. But the first of them was around fisheries, and particularly if you can tell us any more about plans in the area of inshore fisheries and how that will affect fishing effort within the three-mile limit. Obviously, this is something that's of great interest on the West Coast.
Yes, I completely understand that. And in relation to inshore fisheries, I know that the member in the committee will be aware of the cooperation agreement with the Scottish Green Party, where we set out a number of measures that we're looking at in relation to the inshore fisheries and in relation to putting a cap on activity, but as well as our intention to introduce highly protected marine areas, which would cover about 10% of our sea area. And so there will be, of course, we'll be following the due process in relation to that and consulting and engaging with communities, with the fisheries sector as well, as we look to introduce these measures. But there's also the future fisheries management strategy, which was published towards the tail end of last year. We'll also be publishing an action plan on that for delivery towards the end of this year. But of course, in my role, I undertake a lot of engagement with the various different inshore fisheries groups. I met with the regional inshore fisheries groups, the chairs of these groups, just earlier this week, and will continue to engage with the sector. I mean, as the member will be aware, there are a lot of competing interests within our marine environment, whether that's renewable energy, as well as other fishing interests. We also have to try and improve our marine environment and protect our fish stocks and improve our marine biodiversity too. So there will be a lot of challenges coming up over the next few years, but it's that engagement, that consultation, so we fully understand all the issues and work with communities as we look to develop our future proposals.
Thank you. You mentioned designations and you mentioned working with communities. One of the issues in some parts of the country, at least anyway, in the past, has been about trying to move towards a more local management of marine designations, and that's happened in some places but not others. I mean, is this something the government will be seeking to make real, the local management, wherever possible, of these designations?
Absolutely, because I think where we have that local management in place, I know that there's been a couple of pilots there that seems to be operating really well, and that's where we'd welcome proposals from the regional inshore fisheries groups about how that can be done in other areas, because I think that local management and that local ownership of it is really important if we want to be able to make progress. So I think that will be a critical part of our work as we go forward.
Can I just ask, just in the back of the question there about the inshore fisheries groups? The Clare Committee produced a report last year that identified that there was specific issues with capacity and funding for the inshore fisheries groups, which you've already mentioned are really important. Is there any plans to improve the funding for these groups to carry out the good work when it comes to inshore fisheries?
I mean, again, as I said, I met with the regional inshore fisheries groups earlier this week, where we talked about, I mean, if there is going to be future engagement, and we want them to continue on in the work that they're doing, the support that they would be needing for that. So, of course, these are issues that we will continue to consider as we move forward, because we want to make sure that the groups have the resources that they need to enable them to, like say, look at issues such as the local, future local management plans, and to undertake the engagement that we will need to happen. So, of course, we will continue to discuss that with them.
Thank you. On another subject, but again about involving people, it's the issue of crofting law, which I know you're aware of, and although it doesn't feature in this year's legislative programme, I was just keen to know whether any planning is being done around what future crofting reform legislation might look like, given the fact that we do have a body of work that's been done in the form of the attractively named crofting law sump. Of potential changes that could be made. So can I ask, is that going to be made use of and given consideration or consideration to by the government?
You're absolutely right. We know that there's a lot of work that's already been undertaken, and unfortunately we weren't able to progress that in the last term of the Parliament. And even though it's not in the programme for government this year, we have made a commitment to modernising crofting law. So obviously we will be making sure that we utilise and look to all the work that's been done on this so far. However, you'll be aware, and the committee will be aware, that crofting legislation is really complex, and it's not expected that any future work that we undertake on that is going to be straightforward. So the previous work that had been undertaken really highlighted some of the difficulties that we have in reaching consensus on some of the key matters that are a lot of important matters, some of them that have seemed to be simple. So building consensus around some of these issues is going to be key in driving this work forward. But I do want to assure you and to assure the committee that the work that has been previously undertaken by the Crofting Law Group and the Law Society will be standing us in good stead when work on crofting form commences. And in terms of timescale, it is still to be, we're still to find a time in the legislative programme for that. And of course, any decisions on that would be taken by Cabinet in the context of setting out the future legislative programmes in the normal way. But again, I would reiterate that commitment that we have committed to modernising crofting law and will be intending taking that forward.
Thank you. Finally, convener, there's a consultation underway just now around the government's policy on islands bonds. Is the government open? I'm sure the government is open to seeing what's in that consultation, but what scope do you feel there is to refine that policy as it goes to make sure it meets everyone's needs?
There will be a lot of scope to define that as it develops, because you know this consultation is open, as you've mentioned, but it is entirely open too. So obviously we've committed to developing £5 million island bonds, which would, the intention of that is to offer 100 bonds of £50,000 to young people and families. Now that could be either to encourage people to move to islands that are where there's a fragile population or where they're suffering from depopulation, or it could be to help keep people on our islands too. But again, we're very much at the early stages of this, and we're really keen to hear what people think about it. I've already been inundated with lots of emails about it, so I hope that we get a really high return rate for this consultation, and I would encourage everyone to take part in that and to make their views clear. We'll also have to undertake an island community's impact assessment as part of that work too, and we want to make sure that we we do that work early so it can help inform how this policy develops. But we certainly are open at this stage, and that's where the consultation is really important in helping to shape this policy. And this is just one measure. I mean, it's not expected that this will radically resolve some of the depopulation issues that I know some islands are experiencing, but just one tool that can be used to help tackle some of those issues.
Thank you, Convener.
Okay, thank you. We're now going to jump back to fisheries and ask Karen and then Beatrice to ask some questions on fishery policy.
Thank you. As you're aware, the fishing industry has had quite a hard time of late, particularly the double whammy of COVID and Brexit, and they are naturally concerned for their future. With that feeling of vulnerability, they're now quite sceptical of the cooperation agreement with the Greens, and I was just wondering if you could say anything to alleviate fears, in particular in terms of the distribution of quota and looking to tackle discards and bycatch. Can you tell us a bit more about how this has been worked on within the future fisheries management strategy? Thank you.
Yes, absolutely. I mean, in relation to your first point about the cooperation agreement with the Greens, I mean, engagement with different stakeholders is an absolutely critical part of my job. And it's something that I've sought to do since I've been appointed. And of course, since we made the announcements about the cooperation agreement, I've sought to meet with fisheries stakeholders to discuss any concerns or any potential issues that they might have in relation to that. But the fact is, we do still want to see sustainable development across our fisheries sector. I understand that there are concerns there, but a really important part of, as we move through this, the agreement that we've reached and the policies that we've outlined there is about engagement and consultation, looking at the evidence we have to make sure that we're basing our decisions on the best available evidence. And again, working with stakeholders, that engagement is an absolutely critical part of that process. There are a lot of issues in the marine environment. I spoke a bit earlier about the increasingly cluttered landscape that we see in our seas and the competing interests that there can be between fisheries, renewable energy, as well as trying to protect our marine environment in the best way that we can. So we just, again, want to assure you and assure the committee that we will be engaging and going through the proper process as we look to develop the policies that we've set out in the cooperation agreement. In relation to some of the other issues that you've raised there about catching policy, we of course have set out in quite a few details within the programme for government about how we intend to move that forward and our work on fisheries forward. But of course, the pandemic that we've been through, as you said, just the impact that we've seen on the seafood and fisheries industry in particular, I think it's shown how we need to boost the resilience of the industry overall and really try and strengthen the links between the catching sector and onshore interests. So whether that's through looking at diversification of fishing opportunities as well as attracting new entrants too. So we're really wanting to tackle some of the known issues that we know that we have. So when you look at the landing obligation, we will be introducing a future catching policy, and that's really to try and take a tailored approach to tackling discards and reducing unwanted catch through various technical and spatial measures. And we intend to consult on that before the end of the year and intend to introduce legislation on that next year. And we'll, as I said in a previous response as well, we'll also be publishing a delivery plan which sets out our plans for delivering the future fisheries management strategy and the 12 points that are within that, which I think will really address a lot of the issues that are being experienced there. And that had strong backing from all of our stakeholders too, and that really will be a critical piece of work. And I think it's also important to note that coming back to the cooperation agreement, that really will build on what we've seen set out in the future fisheries management strategy.
Thank you. And just coming back there, you touched upon enticing new entrants into the industry. I know there's been fantastic work in and around women in agriculture, and I was just wondering, is there any scope, you know, to look at a kind of programme for women in aquaculture and fisheries?
But yes, you're absolutely right. I mean, that is a key piece of work that we've taken forward when we look at agriculture. But we are also working closely with the Scottish fishing industry through the Scottish Fishing Safety Group. Well, that's about improving safety for all fishers. And that group recently received £140,000 through the Marine Fund Scotland to deliver free safety training for fishing vessel crews. And we're also, as well as that, in looking at the safety aspect, we're carrying out specific research into the barriers that will face new entrants and that face specific equalities groups, such as women, to entering and really progressing through the fishing industry. And we'll be looking to take specific action in relation to that through the Future Fisheries Management strategy to make sure that we have the right support in place. In addition to that, as well, through the Marine Fund, new entrants are also able to apply for funding towards the purchase of a second-hand fishing vessel. So between looking at new entrants, looking at women, like you say, just in the same way that we've done in agriculture, we realise that there is more scope for diversity there, and we want to ensure that we make the industry as open and as accessible as possible.
Thank you.
Thank you. I'm going to bring Jenny in for a supplementary on fishing before moving to Beatrice.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you, Cabinet Secretary, for attending. It's a sort of follow-on from Karen's question with regards to the local ability for processing of fish, and also given Brexit and the impact that that's been had on our local fishermen and inshore fishermen, how the Scottish Government can support them to perhaps change their market from Europe to Scotland, and what support you're giving them.
You're absolutely right, and especially, well, we know in processing that there have been huge issues there, and huge issues as a result of Brexit, as outlined in my opening statement as well. So that's where we're working on a strategy that will be delivered next year, looking at the various opportunities and what we can do to work with the industry and to try and develop some of the markets and find new markets based on what's been lost that we've seen through leaving the EU. So we very much intend, we've been working with the industry throughout that to develop the strategy, and we'll continue to work with them on implementing that. But of course, we want to see the industry be a success. Again, I mean, Jim Fairley touched earlier on the labour element of that as well, and that's also a critical issue. Spoken to some seafood processors who've highlighted that and the serious problems that they now face in terms of the recruitment challenges. And I think when we look at the proportion of the EU workforce and when it comes to seafood processing, I think that's been about nearly 60% of the workforce has been from EU or EU citizens. And in Grampian, the proportion of that is even higher. I think it's about 70% or even higher than that. So again, that's where we continue to press to try and resolve some of the immediate and critical issues. But we also want to try and encourage people to do what we can within Scotland to encourage people into these sectors and to really develop and help the industry as much as we can.
Thank you. Thank you. Beatrice.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary. First of all, can I thank you for taking the time to come to Shetland in the early days of your new appointment, and I hope it's not the last time we see you in Shetland. Can I ask about vessel tracking and monitoring systems and what the plans are and the potential issues you see in trying to monitor movements of fishing vessels via GPS? We know that there are concerns about fisheries enforcement, so I'd be interested to get your take on that.
Well, thank you. Yes, I had a very busy visit to Shetland, and of course I met with fishers when I was there too, and some from the seafood industry. And I can tell you it will not be my last visit there, and I fully intend to keep that engagement going and to visit again when I can. Now, when it comes to remote electronic monitoring, I understand there may be some concerns there, but I think that this is something that is actually a really positive measure. It helps us build a picture, and I think when it comes to monitoring and enforcement, it fills in those data gaps, and I think it actually will work to the benefit of fishers. I mean, occasionally right now we can see in some areas where people can be accused of either entering or undertaking activity in marine protected areas when that hasn't been the case. And I think this actually will help protect the industry in some ways from some accusations like that when that can occur. It also helps build data and evidence for us. As I said, we've outlined our plans to develop a suite of highly protected marine areas, as well as introducing management measures for marine protected areas and protecting priority marine features. So being able to look at vessel activity, where that activity is taking place, is going to be absolutely vital. So that's where I see this as a really positive step.
And how does that impact on the enforcement in terms of foreign vessels? You'll be aware of the concerns that some have expressed that foreign vessels are boarded more often than UK or Scottish vessels.
Yes, I understand that the concerns there about that, and I've received a fair bit of correspondence on that from various members too. But I would say that we've had freedom of information requests that have been published on this, which show that isn't necessarily the case. But I would also inform the committee that when it comes to compliance and some of the other issues that we're seeing, some of that is the responsibility of the Maritime and Coast Guard Agency, and I'd actually requested a meeting with them, which I think may have been arranged at some point soon, I can't remember the exact date, to discuss some of the issues that we're seeing and how we can try and prevent some of the conflicts from taking place. But I mean, the measures that we introduce in Scotland, it's not just for our vessels, and we want to ensure that all vessels are part of this programme, and that this is done in a fair and transparent way.
Can I move on to the aquaculture sector and ask if there's a timescale for the regulatory reform?
Yes, I'm sure the committee will be aware that we appointed Professor Russell Griggs to lead on this piece of work. So I'd be happy to send the terms of reference for that to the committee if they haven't got that already. But we are expecting a report by the end of the year. The first few months are the fact-finding, where we'll be expecting to have recommendations from Professor Griggs as to the areas that we need to look at for reform and other pieces of work. So certainly within the next few months, we would expect to see the initial outcome from the first phase of that review before looking at further actions.
Thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you. I've got one final question on inshore fisheries. There's moves to look at banning or bringing back a 3-mile limit for mobile fishing gear, which will almost certainly lead to an increase in static gear. At the moment, there's the suggestion that in inshore waters, static gear is a source of mortality in humpback whales, which could actually be occurring at the rate in order of a magnitude that would render the species unsustainable. Can you tell us what the government's policies would be to ensure the right balance between static and mobile fishing gear and an impact on species like humpback whales and whatever?
Well, in relation to your first point about the 3-mile limit, I mean, that's not a policy that we've agreed to or adopted, because we don't agree with taking a blanket approach given how different and variable the coastline of Scotland is. And that's where a tailored approach is seen to be a lot more effective and beneficial. And that's where the work that we've done through the fisheries, the Future Fisheries Management Strategy with the regional inshore fisheries groups, and looking at local management, where that can work, has been really vital in helping to inform how we move forward and how we handle some of the issues that you've outlined there. So that's very much the approach that we've taken so far, that engagement, that consultation, and looking at the different environments that we have surrounding our coastal communities in Scotland. So I think that's the approach that makes sense, and that's certainly the approach that we fully intend to continue.
Okay, thanks. I'm going to move on to Mercedes with questions on islands.
Thanks, Convener, and thank you to the Cabinet Secretary for coming before the committee this morning. So in the Cabinet Secretary's opening remarks, she said that the government's taking on board what island communities say that they want. And there's been much talk of island community impact assessments. So does the Cabinet Secretary think that the Scottish Government
has had sufficient concern for island communities and island economies in Hyle's decision to push ahead with the process of centralisation?
I mean, obviously, as you mentioned there, the Islands Act, we have a duty to take islands issues into account when developing or reviewing policies, strategies or services as part of island communities' impact assessments, and that's a legal requirement. And of course, that's a hugely important point when we're looking to develop policy. So I think that they have been effective in helping to identify issue, but of course we continue to engage with communities and stakeholders as part of the island community impact assessment process in relation to a wide range of policies and services that are being developed. And that includes transport, health, and various aspects of food and drink too. So, and we also look to get feedback throughout that process as well. And I think if there's anything helpful that we can do that helps update our guidance and our toolkit, then that's very much what we would look to do. And in relation to your specific point about Hyle, I mean, I'm sure the member will be aware that this is within the remit of the Transport Minister, Graham Day, as well. So I think if there are any specific issues you want to follow up within that, I would suggest that the committee contact the Transport Minister, or be happy to provide them with further information.
Okay, thank you very much for that. Well, given this is a publicly owned airline, and that the government has a policy of looking to repopulate islands, I'm surprised that more hasn't been done. It's good to hear that you're engaging with different stakeholders, and yeah, I'm aware that it falls under the remit of the Transport Minister. The workers and the trade union representatives have written to the Transport Minister to meet with him. Would you encourage him to meet with them?
I know that the Transport Minister has been undertaking engagement in and around this issue, but again, I'd be happy to ask the Transport Minister to get in touch with the committee and to outline the work that's been happening in this regard, if the committee would find that helpful.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Just on that, last night we had a very interesting debate on ferries brought forward by the committee member here, Alistair Allen. Obviously, ferries are 100% connected to islands by their very nature. If we were to look at further pieces of work on ferries to islands and potentially the makeup of the board of CalMAC and so on, is that something that you would take up, given it's solely our islands affair, or is it something that we should take up with the Minister for Transport?
I mean, it's not solely an islands affair, but ferries fall within the remit of the Transport Minister. So I think if there were any specific pieces of work the committee were looking to do in that regard, then it would be the Transport Minister who would be best in place to respond to that.
Okay, thank you. We're now going to move on to some questions on animal welfare from Rachel.
Thank you, Convener. Cabinet Secretary, you'll be aware that BASC, with the support of rural workers, are calling for the formation of a task group, and that was to consider the findings of the Scottish Government research on that, which you commissioned. I just wondered why that wasn't in the programme for government, and if it was something that the Scottish Government were considering taking forward.
I'm really sorry, I missed the first part of that question in relation to the task force, what you were asking for?
Yeah, so you commissioned research on the abuse of Scottish gamekeepers, and I wondered why that wasn't included in your programme for government, if you had any intention to take that forward on behalf of rural workers.
I'd be happy to come back to the member and to the committee with more information on the stage to which that work reached. Obviously, there is a lot of work ongoing within and across government, which isn't necessarily detailed point by point in the programme for government. But in relation to that, again, I'd be happy to get back to the committee.
Okay, my next question is, how soon can we expect the grouse licensing and modernisation of the Deer Act? Who will be responsible for taking that forward, and which committee will scrutinise the points of licensing?
I mean, in relation to committee scrutiny, I mean, again, as we touched on earlier, that would be a point for the Bureau to discuss with the committee as to which committee would be best placed to consider which relevant pieces of legislation. When it comes to wildlife and some of the issues that you've mentioned there about the the Grasmere Management Review and the response to the DEAR Working Group as well. These are issues that are the responsibility of the Minister for Environment and Land Reform, Mary McCallan, who would be the lead minister in relation to those.
Can the Cabinet Secretary give us a bit more information about what it means in the Programme for Government when it says the Scottish Government will review the wider species licensing system?
The species licensing in general.
We understand the, you know, the grouse moor licensing or the other licensing that you're likely to bring in, but do you have any detail on what it means when you say in the programme of government wider species?
Well, obviously we do license a number of various different species in Scotland, and as we've talked about there in relation to looking at licensing for grouse moor, we also have licences in relation to beavers. Some of this work has been set out in the draft cooperation, in the cooperation agreement with the Scottish Green Party as well. So this is really to ensure that our licensing scheme works in the way that we hope it does and is effective in that way.
On the Fox Control Bill, considering your role as Cabinet Secretary, to support wider rural economy and the countryside, people who work in there, rural workers, what role will you play to ensure that those rural areas and people that work in it are able to support and protect their livestock and livelihoods? How will you be part of that, considering you've said that Mary McCallan will lead on the Fox Control Bill?
I mean, as I mentioned previously, as a minister who worked between two different cabinet secretaries as well, you're not working in isolation, and especially when these issues concern various other aspects across wider portfolios. So, of course, there will be close working around that. But then it's also a responsibility that as we develop legislation and we look to develop these proposals, you know, I did this in my previous role, I do it in my role now, that you engage with all your stakeholders, with people that are going to be affected by the legislation. And it's also a critical part of any piece of legislation that there's open consultation, so we get the feedback on the proposals that we need to help us shape that legislation and frame it in the best possible way. So that work will be undertaken in the process of developing that legislation. But there is always a lead minister or a lead cabinet secretary to take forward various bits of legislation, depending on where it falls in the portfolio. And as I've mentioned previously, this falls within the portfolio of the Environment and Land Reform Minister, who will be taking the lead on that.
I think it might be helpful if, at a later stage, particularly for my benefit, and I don't know about other committee members, as to why something like that would fall in another portfolio, particularly when it is regarding control of a pest to protect livestock, which is under your remit. But I can move on. I've got another question regarding to Forestry and Land Scotland's powers. I just wondered if there was any plan to update the powers that they have with regards to controlling deer population as we move to planting more trees across Scotland, particularly when it comes to the welfare of pregnant female hinds.
I know that this has been an issue that's been received quite a lot of attention recently, but I think, you know, that when we look at deer numbers across Scotland, they've almost doubled from the period from 1990 to now. And of course, managing numbers is absolutely necessary to reduce the damage, the ecological damage that they can do, as well as to protect young trees. So that's absolutely imperative in helping to tackle the climate and biodiversity crisis. And you know, just to assure commitment, it comes to this as well, that activity is licensed by Nature Scot. Welfare is obviously taken very seriously, whether considering to authorise the taking of deer during the period of the highest welfare risk to dependent young. And the people that undertake that activity have to be trained, they go through rigorous training to comply with best practice on that. And I think what we've seen announced recently isn't a routine operation, but Forestry and Land Scotland is responding to the annual surveys that they do of crop damage and habitat impacts from deer, and really trying to prioritise deer management on vulnerable areas of land. And a substantial number of Scotland's land management organisations both recognise the need for ongoing control of deer populations and acknowledge that, that Forestry and Land Scotland delivers deer management to the highest possible standards. And you know, just to come back to the previous point as well that you made at the start of your question there, and in relation to where it falls, I mean, and where various bits and pieces fall, again, that wildlife management is the responsibility of the Minister for Environment and Land Reform, and that's why the legislation in that regard will be led by that Minister.
Okay, I think we'll work out where it lies in terms of scrutiny as well, and that joint responsibility between the two committees. Convener, may I just ask the last question, and it's just not about animal welfare, but it was something regarding future farm policy. It was actually about the how the current Scottish tenancy legislation will fit in with the conditionality of public goods for public money. And I just wondered how the Cabinet Secretary will get involved in informing maybe future land reform that has an effect on Scottish tenants who may potentially be breaching rules of husbandry where agricultural production is of paramount importance in their role as a tenant.
Yes, obviously. I mean, in relation to the tenant farmers, this is we've made a PFG commitment in that regard, and that would be undertaken through land reform legislation. So, of course, it'd be closely involved in that work. And we also want to ensure that tenant farmers can play as full a role as possible in when we're looking at, you know, being able to undertake measures for climate mitigation and emissions reductions. And there are a number of various schemes that are being worked on in that regard, and to ensure that that can happen.
Thank you. We're going to jump back to agriculture with some questions from Ariane. But before that, you have a commitment to establish a new Scottish veterinary service. Could you just set out what you aim to achieve, what the outcomes will be, and an indication of how long you think it will take to set this up?
Yes, absolutely. I mean, I'm happy to give the committee a bit of background as to where this came from as well. So we'd had an independent review of the current field services that are delivered by the Animal Health, the Animal and Plant Health Agency, and that was commissioned by ministers a couple of years ago now, really to ensure that it still delivers, continues to offer value for money, and to see whether any other models could deliver efficiencies or improve the effectiveness of that. And the report that was carried out into that was published early last year, and it gave 10 recommendations. And that included the creation of a standalone Scottish Animal Health and Welfare Delivery Body that would, it was felt, best meet Scotland's long-term interests. So we've recently asked Professor Milne, who undertook that work, to revisit that report and to look at the manifesto commitment and to update his report to take account of the changes that have taken place since then, because obviously we've seen the impact of EU exit, the new animal health regulations and COVID-19, and we're expecting that report back in October. But when it comes to a new Scottish veterinary service itself, we expect that would at least be established within the lifetime of the Parliament. And of course, that would be subject to ensuring that we get the parliamentary time to deliver that. The initial work that's expected to create that would be estimated to take around 18 months to do. But there's obviously a lot of information that we have to scope out as part of that process, and look at when we consider how we're going to deliver the most effective model and what the most effective model would be. But we think that, as I say, hopefully within the lifetime of this Parliament, we'll be able to undertake that work, secure the parliamentary time to deliver a veterinary service that works for Scotland and delivers for Scotland.
Okay, we'll now move on to Ariane.
Thanks, Convener. Thank you, Cabinet Secretary, for joining us this morning. And it's good to hear you laying out a lot of diverse challenges that you're facing, but you know, the work to transition our rural areas in response to climate emergency and biodiversity loss. And that is, in terms of agriculture, where my question is. I'm curious to hear a little bit more detail about how you see that. I mean, I think you talked about it a little bit with Jim Fairley's questions, but I'm curious to hear a little bit more about how that will show up in new agriculture and land use policies.
I suppose the key thing that we're looking at, I mean, obviously we've done the work through, well, there've been through the farmer-led groups who delivered a suite of recommendations, and that was a manifesto commitment that we would deliver on that. And I met the chairs of the farmer-led groups earlier in the summer, not long after being appointed, who were all really, you know, quite enthusiastic and keen to get to work and seeing those recommendations delivered and to play their part in reducing emissions in Scotland, because I think that there are going to be huge challenges here. I don't think there's any getting around that or anybody would underplay that. But I think that we are at a point that we can be world leaders in Scotland when it comes to sustainable agriculture and why we want to work alongside industry with farmers and with land managers in trying to deliver that. So in terms of what the detailed proposals of that might look like, of course, that'll be for the work of the board to work through, to develop proposals, to test those proposals, to see what will work most effectively. But of course, as I said in the previous response, what we'd committed to in our manifesto as well was in shifting half of the funding that we currently have for farming and crofting to conditional support by 2025. So, of course, a key part of that will be, you know, while I can't give the specific measures or what that might look like, and we're still to do that work and co-develop that, it will, of course, be ensuring that every farm business is, you know, reducing their emissions to the lowest possible level and doing what they can to restore and protect biodiversity across their farm businesses as well. So I think that the biodiversity and emissions reductions will be key component parts of that.
And just following on from that, in the agreement or the programme for government, we talked about organics and doubling the amount of organics from I think the current amount is 1.9%, and I'm aware that in Europe they're calling for 25% organics, and obviously we can't just suddenly make that leap. Do you see this doubling of organics, like a small amount, as a step in the direction to a larger direction in the future? Now, obviously, we've got 5 years to do this doubling. Land takes time to transition to organic. But underneath all of it, what we're really talking about is soil fertility, soil health, if we want something for future generations. So I'd love to hear a little bit more about long-term thoughts around organic farming.
Absolutely. And as you've said out there, the EU target is very ambitious. It's 25%. And as you've said there, I mean, the amount of land that we have being farmed organically is currently at about 1.7%. So I think that the target that we have is achievable, because I don't think there's any point in serving or setting targets that would be so far out of reach that we haven't got a chance of getting there. We've got to be pragmatic, but also be ambitious with what we can do as well. Because I think that's one area that has been of concern, is the fact that we've seen the amount of land being farmed organically over recent times reduce, when, of course, we would want to see that improve and increase. And what we set out in the cooperation party, in the cooperation agreement, is that we would want to see that at least double by the end of this parliamentary session. So, at least a double. So, hopefully, we could see it raised further than that. If we can, then I hope we absolutely would be able to get there. But we also will be delivering as well on an action plan for organic farming. We had a previous plan in place up until 2020, so we'll build on the work that's been done through that, and of course, work with the organic sector too to make sure that we're working together, looking at the different actions we can take to, you know, first of all, increase the amount of land that's being farmed organically, and in relation to organic produce, how we can look at what we can do in that regard. Obviously, A critically important part of that as well is the Food for Life scheme that we have, which obviously looks to get more organic produce into local authorities and being served in our schools. That's an initiative that we very much support and are very much keen to see continue. I think just over half the local authorities in Scotland are now signed up to that scheme as well. And a critical part of that that we'd also set out in our manifesto is, you know, how we can also look to harness the wider public procurement spending power that we have in relation and looking at the scheme that we have for Food for Life and how we can really embed that and look to expand that across the wider public sector, all of which I think will help develop the work that we do on organics too.
Thank you,
Ariane. Sorry, just before we move away from that topic, can I bring Jim in a question on organic farming?
Ariane, sorry to interrupt you on that, but I'm keen to bore down a wee bit into this, Cabinet Secretary. Being a hard-nosed farmer as I was, finances are usually the driver for making anybody do anything in terms of trying to make a sustainable business. So have you allocated an amount of money that you're going to put into actually persuading people to go organic? Have you done a cost-benefit analysis of the amount of money you're going to have to put in to do it? And have you looked at organic versus regenerative? And I don't want to set one off against the other, but regenerative and organic are not the same things, Ariane. They're definitely not the same thing. So I just want to know, have you looked at regenerative as opposed to organic? Do you look at them both, as Ariane does, as being the same thing? And, you know, how serious are you about really pushing that area of farming in Scotland?
I think there's space for all of this, and it's certainly not about pitting one sector against the other, and I very much don't intend to do that at all. In relation to support for organics, I mean, organics and conversion for that and the certification costs are currently met through the agri-environment scheme that we have. So since 2015, we've spent about, I think, between 19 and 20 million on our organic conversion, and I know that there are specific costs related to that, and we need to do what we can to support those who are thinking of converting to organic. So I think that if we're looking to expand the amount of land that we farm organically, then of course the support that's there will be a critical element of that. But of course, all agricultural support is going to be considered by the Implementation Oversight Board that we've established. I'm sure that there will be discussions about this and further proposals developed as we move forward.
Sorry, I don't wish to steal your position here. I visited a regenerative farm along with Soil Association Scotland, and they're working very closely together, and they appreciate that there are slight differences. So I would just encourage the Cabinet Secretary to have a word with the Soil Association Scotland in relation to what they're doing with the regenerative side of things.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, the Soil Association are one of our key stakeholders as well. I've met with them over the course of the summer, and you know, we'll continue to engage with them as we move forward. And also an important part for me is getting out and about and meeting different farmers from across Scotland too. So again, that's something I fully intend to do and to keep doing.
Okay, we'll go back to Ariana and then Jenny Minto.
Okay. Thanks, Jim, for deepening the conversation there. And thank you, Cabinet Secretary, for your answers. And we'll be having a chat over tea about regenerative and organic and how they work together, like Russian dolls or something. Anyway, to continue on, I'm going to move on to food, the product of organic soil, food and drink. And actually, we've been talking about long-term future, but now I'd love to just hear a little bit. I think the committee's keen to hear about you know, issues of the implications of the EU exit for food and drink sector, and how the import and exports have been functioning 9 months on from the end of the transition period, and to let us know if there's any ongoing issues in any particular sectors.
Yes, there's probably quite a lot to unpack in that question as well, so I'll try and answer as best as I can. I mean, I know that the committee took evidence on that on this last week, and you'll be aware of some of the impacts that we've seen. And there's been some well-publicised impacts. It was Andrew Faithney from East of Scotland Growers just last week There'd been an article about the critical shortages that they're seeing. I think labour is one element we've touched on today. That's been a critical element there too, in relation to, you know, we're seeing so much food go to waste. I think he'd highlighted there's about 2.5 million heads of broccoli, 1.5 million heads of cauliflower, because they're isn't the labour there to be able to deal with that. So labour is a critical issue right across the piece. And, you know, that is down to us no longer having freedom of movement. I also talked about labour and the importance of the processing sector and some of the percentages that we see there. So, of course, there is going to be a huge impact when we put a stop to the free movement of people. In relation to trade, there's been an absolutely huge impact there as well. I mentioned in the food and drink debate last week that I think in January alone, it cost the food and drink industry about £700 million just for that 1 month because of EU exit and, of course, the barriers that are now there for trade. And that's the thing, these barriers aren't going to go away. We've had, in particular relation to seafood, there was a task force which has now morphed into an action group with the UK government and work through a lot of these issues and barriers as best we can. However, there are more barriers that are due to come in over the coming months. And again, there is no way of avoiding that. You know, a lot of that has come in the way of export health certificates. There'll be new requirements that, you know, had been due to come into force, I think, by the end of this month, that are now coming in January, which will affect aquaculture in particular. So I think that we continue to see these issues, and like I say, they won't be getting better from here. If anything, there will be more checks and more issues the longer that we go on, and all of that just serves to hamper the food and drink industry, right from primary producer to manufacturer to the other end of the spectrum. We're seeing the impacts of that right across the board.
Thank you for that. And I've got one more question, Convener. And this is going to, it's kind of like a combination question around your remit and islands. And it's a question about housing and land. Having visited the Orkney, Shetland and the Western Isles over the recess, housing, you know, I think that, you know, the big piece for me as a Highlands and Islands MSP is the whole piece around repeopling, keeping people who want to stay in their villages and in place, and housing is a big part of that. Of course, jobs is the other part of the equation, but housing seemed to come up everywhere I went, and I just wanted to hear and the issue of lack of land in some places to actually build the houses. For example, Barra, the land is actually, it's all under crofting tenure, and there isn't really much space to build housing. In other places, it's, yes, the land is owned by a community trust, but the places, for example, in Harris are very, very difficult to get to. So house builders don't want to take on the job, and yet there's the funding in place to do it. So I just wondered where your role fits as Cabinet Secretary with islands in your title in terms of supporting housing to happen in the island, in our island communities.
Absolutely. I mean, as the member in the committee will be aware, I mean, islands, there's obviously so many different issues that impact on our islands communities that aren't necessarily, even though I'm responsible for islands, don't directly fall within my remit. So when it comes to housing in our rural areas and our island communities, that falls within the remit of Shona Robison as Cabinet Secretary responsible for housing. But of course, that there is a strong interest, like I say, obviously, there are strong crossovers between that and between my responsibilities. I mean, like you, I was out across our islands in the summer. I visited Isla and Colonsay with Jenny Minto and was in Orkney and Shetland as well. And what was really interesting was going to Colonsay too, where, you know, a lack of affordable housing was a huge issue. You know, we heard from some people there, you know, whose family had been there for generations, but, you know, someone living in a caravan because there wasn't the housing there for them. And we have job opportunities that were in that area, but there wasn't the housing there to enable employees or for people to live on the island. And I think about it was over 40% of the homes that are on Colonsay are either second or holiday homes. So there are undoubtedly issues there, but I think that another positive about that visit, though, was the fact that We have the Rural and Islands Housing Fund, and that's what I was there to launch because we've been able to invest together with Maui, who were also investing there in helping to deliver new housing for the community, which will have a hugely positive impact. And within the PFG as well, within the cooperation agreement, we talked about developing an action plan for rural and island housing, as well as committing £45 million for rural and island communities. Because I think, you know, I talked earlier about the islands bonds and how that's not going to resolve a lot of these issues on its own, because of course there are a lot of issues that can affect why people live on islands, why people feel they can't live on islands or may have to leave. And you're right, housing is a critical element of that. But hopefully through this programme, through this funding and engaging with communities on looking at that action plan, we can really identify where the critical problems are and try and address that as best as we possibly can. And hopefully that will help alongside some of the other measures that I've outlined today too.
Thank you for that, Cabinet Secretary.
Okay, we'll move on to Jenny Minto.
Great, thank you. Yes, Mary, it was an interesting couple of days on Islay and Colonsay, and I know that you visited Shetland after the Argyll and Bute Islands, and I think you'll have picked up, as I certainly have, visiting a wider array of islands in my constituency, that each island is different, and I was pleased to hear you talk about a tailored approach to agriculture and fisheries, and I'm hoping that the same tailored approach will be given to islands as well, because as you've highlighted, different islands have different needs. Jura, for example, has benefited hugely in the last 10 years from a very clear community action plan, but it's now reached the point where there's nobody with free volunteer time to actually continue that development of that island. So it's looking at that compared to other islands that you highlighted, perhaps Colonsay there as well, so the different approaches that are needed. So I'm interested to understand a bit more about the infrastructure spend that was announced and highlighted yesterday, but also a bit more about the carbon neutral islands, because again, in Argyll and Bute and across island communities, for example, Tyree has got a community wind turbine, which has given them a really strong funding base, which can allow them to do more stuff in their communities. So it's interesting. I'm interested to know how different islands are at different stages again with that, and how the piloting will work. Thank you.
Thank you for those questions. And yeah, I'd also heard your speech yesterday in the programme for government debate, discussing some of those the renewable energy potential and developments that are taking place across your constituency and the opportunities there. And that's where it was really interesting going around some of the different islands, because you're absolutely right. You know, no one island is the same. There are different challenges, there are different opportunities. And our proposal in relation to carbon neutral islands, we're still at the very early stages of that as well. So of course we'll be engaging with island communities, with local authorities too, to see how we can take that forward and whichever islands those might be, because it's really interesting to hear what you say there about the different developments. And on Tyree, and of course, when you look at islands like Orkney as well, where we've seen the tidal developments too, and there's so much going on. And I think that that's where there's a real opportunity when it comes to our islands and really capturing and really leading the way when it comes to tackling our climate emissions and reaching that net zero capability, and they harness a lot of that. So again, but at the early initial stages of that work, and of course I'll keep the committee up to date on that as we move forward and as that work progresses too. In relation to the, I think it was, did you mention the infrastructure fund there as well? I mean, we have the Islands Programme, which has set out £30 million of funding over the course of the next 5 years. So that's split into three separate programmes for this coming year, with £9.5 million being spent. So we have the Islands Infrastructure Fund, which is £6.2 million. So there are two projects that have been allocated funding from that so far, and the rest of that will be distributed across the islands authorities. There's the Islands Communities Fund, which is a fund of £2 million. So that had opened earlier, and I think we'll be announcing the projects that have been successful through that soon. And also over the course of the summer, I launched the Healthy Islands Fund as well, which is a fund of £1.3 million. And all of these funds together, it's obviously recognising that island communities have had specific challenges that we've seen throughout the course of the pandemic. Healthy Islands will hopefully help to. It's also an outcome that we've seen from the National Islands Plan as well about improving the health of and mental well-being of people on our islands. And that fund is really designed to help and address some of those issues. Through the Communities Fund and the Infrastructure Fund, we're looking for projects that will hopefully have an impact, and as we look to make that transition to become a green economy, that are going to create jobs and help retain jobs in island communities too. So there is a lot of work that's currently underway, but again, that's going to be a five-year programme of spend, and those are the allocations that have been made this year, but there will be more coming down the line, and hopefully we'll start to see the positive impacts that have been coming from these funds and the projects very soon.
Thank you.
Thank you. Jim's got a question on food and drink.
Thanks, convener, and sorry to keep coming back to you on stuff, Cabinet Secretary. The food and drink thing, given the size of the industry to Scotland, I think it's vital that we really look in detail, and it's maybe not the right briefing to go into the real detail of this, but there's a couple of things I wanted to mention. The food and drink recovery plan, just what the details are of where you think that's going at the moment and what's going to have to do going forward. I know that you've got the Business Development Academy, where you've got 60 food and drink businesses have signed up to it, and you've got every major industry body has signed up to delivering it. But I also just wanted to touch on Sustainably Scottish, what it means, what it's going to deliver, where it fits in, and where the current brands that we have fit in to the Scottish brand, and how are we going to define Sustainably Scottish? I know there's a lot in that. That's a very packed question. But if you could just give us a kind of a broad view on where you're thinking on some of that at the moment.
No problem at all. In relation to the Food and Drink Recovery Plan, we funded £5 million over, 2020 to 2021, and another £5 million over the course of 2021-22 to help deliver that. And there's 50 actions that were produced within that. So I'd be happy to write to the committee and provide more information on those actions and some of the work that's been done. I mean, we had the Regional Food Fund. That's just one project that's been delivered through that as well, which I launched in Shetland over the summer, really to try and showcase and develop new markets for our food and drink, and that was really positively welcomed there, because I think we do have the best produce anywhere in the world, and I think it's really important that we highlight that and showcase that and do what we can to develop markets for that as best we can, and especially in light of some of the challenges that we've faced over this past while too. And on the back of that, also in relation to some of the other funding that we provided £1.8 million to Seafood Scotland, and we've also had the Food Processing, Marketing and Cooperation Grant, which was £7.3 million of funding, which was announced last month as well. All of that with the intention of, you know, helping to keep our food and drink businesses more resilient and to help them as best we can through some of the issues that they face. And part of that, you also went on to talk about Sustainably Scottish as well, because I do think that, you know, our produce is produced in a very sustainable way. I think that we have a lot to show off about in Scotland when it comes to the produce that we have in our food and drink, and a Sustainably Scottish brand is really about trying to capitalise on that. So we're at the early stages of looking at that work as well, but of course we'll be working closely with Scotland Food and Drink to help develop the proposals for that, what that might look like, and to see how we can drive that work forward, because I think it's really important that we highlight our Scottish produce. The fact that it is, you know, sustainably produced, and really capitalising on that as best we can.
Okay, I really would like at some point to be able to come back to the Sustainably Scottish thing, because we have brands that sit within the Scotch brand right now. Where do they fit into the whole thing? are we going to absorb them into sustainably Scottish? So there are layers in this that we really need to drill into, and I'd appreciate being able to come back to it at a later date.
If I could just jump in quickly there, I mean, that's why we'll be working with Scotland Food and Drink and working with other organisations too, to make sure that we capture all that, that it's not competing, that we're able to tie all of that together.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. You touched on the issues we're facing at the moment with the food and drink supply chain, and it's somewhat disappointing, but not surprising that you focused on Brexit. Can you give us some assurance that when you look at the issues that are facing some sectors, so for example the growers, that you do take the time to look at all the issues that are facing them and not focus on Brexit? Because we heard last week that it's a perfect storm where COVID is playing a huge part. The lack of labour is not solely down to Brexit. We see lack of labour in Germany and other, in Poland and other European countries, and ensure that you do look fully into the other reasons for issues. And one of those is the Scottish inability at the moment to grow our own rural workforce, and that there are certainly issues in land-based training that we need to address fairly rapidly to ensure that we've got the workforce for the future, and we have professional dairymen and professional land managers and whatever. So how are you going to bring forward policies to improve our land-based training to ensure we've got a workforce here that's homegrown to address some of the issues that, yep, Brexit will bring to us, but also the impact of COVID?
I mean, in relation to your first point, I mean, there's just no getting away from the fact that Brexit has been, you know, the single biggest factor that is impacting and is having such a huge impact across the food and drink industry. You know, I'm not focusing on that to be political or to be difficult. I mean, look at the industry letters that were sent to the UK government. And I think that we can't just gloss over that and completely forget about it to make it politically convenient for some people, because, you know, you talk about shortages elsewhere. I don't think there's other countries in Europe that are seeing the actual visible shortages on supermarket shelves that we're starting to see here, or who are experiencing the critical level of labour shortages that we are in Scotland. And again, when you look at the letter that was sent by industry to the UK government, now, yes, there were asks of the Scottish government. I responded to that last week and have already outlined what we're doing in Scotland, but we don't have all the levers to fix this or to control this within our power. So, of course, we will always, you know, that's my job, to make sure that we will do what we can to work with industry here and to mitigate that as best we can. But when you don't have all the levers of power or control over the situation, then there is only so much you can do within that. And unfortunately, a lot of those powers rest with the UK government, and they're not doing anything about it at the moment.
Relation to what we do
in Scotland and the action.
On the negative side, will we ensure that the Scottish whisky industry and our salmon industry, which are world leaders and some of our biggest exports, or are our biggest exports, are you going to seize the opportunities that we have in some of the forthcoming trade deals to ensure those fantastic success stories continue?
Okay, there's a few points I want to cover here. I want to come back to the wider piece that you talked about getting people into the food and drink workforce. But touching on trade deals there, it's good for the whisky industry, and we're not against trade deals. But the whole point in this is we shouldn't be supporting trade deals that come at the expense of one of our most critical sectors, which is agriculture. And when you look at the Australian trade deal, it's only expected to benefit our GDP by 0.02%. And who are going to be the hardest hit within that? It's going to be Scottish agriculture. It's going to be our red meat producers. So, again, we're not against trade, but we're not willing to sacrifice some of our most critical and important sectors in order to achieve that. And we would actually really welcome it if the UK government would take some of our concerns on board in relation to that. We also have similar concerns. I mean, the precedent has already been set with the Australian trade deal. We have similar concerns over proposals for a New Zealand trade deal, which I think is even is not even set to increase our GDP at all. I think the last time I saw that was about 0%. There would be no impact assessments done. The Trade and Agriculture Commission that was set up to, were meant to be set up to scrutinise these deals, to look at the impact, haven't even been fully established yet to do that. So I don't think it's fair to just try and cherry pick the very few what could be positive examples out of these trade deals and then just ignore the massive negatives and the massive impact that that will have on critical sectors in the Scottish economy, and which will just disproportionately affect us compared to other parts of the UK. Coming back to some of the work that the Scottish Government's undertaking and what we hope to do over the longer term, and in relation to getting people into the food and drink industry, right, you know, right across the supply chain, that's why we set up a commission to look at to do a root and branch review of land-based learning. So that's right from early years right through. And that, and the commission has members from the education sector as well as those from industry as well, looking at the skills that we need and to see what we can do to promote food and drink industry as a destination of choice. And are we making, is that as open and accessible as what it can be? Are we training people in the right way? One of the great projects that's been going on is with the machinery rings. There's RingLink within my own constituency. I've been working in a pre-apprenticeship programme, working with local schools and giving people that real-world experience and working on farm, which has developed into and helping people end up in positive destinations. So that's why we are taking that longer-term approach and seeing what we can do to improve that skills pipeline for our young people.
Thank you. Alistair Allen.
Thank you very much. I appreciate the point you make that Brexit is not the only factor in all this, but I'm sure, like other members, have had businesses phoning me up. I had one phoning me up just yesterday to say to me that Brexit is a factor in it, and a very big one. You also make a very good point. I'm addressing my remarks, I promise you, to the Minister, but you make a very good point about training. But can I ask the Minister, you'll appreciate that there are some parts of the country where we're getting to the point where there is no workforce to train because there is nowhere for a workforce to live. So can I ask what you feel you can do in your role as Ireland's Minister to bring together different parts of government to ensure we address that question, particularly in parts of the country where the second home market and the holiday let market is having a huge impact on the availability of anywhere to live for anyone.
Yes, you're absolutely right. And, you know, again, that's what I experienced in Colonsay, where, you know, there are job opportunities there, but there was just a lack of adequate housing to be able to really house people, and a lack of affordable housing as well. So, again, that is a critical, important point. And while I'm not directly responsible for housing policy, I met with the Cabinet Secretary for Housing just last week to discuss some of these issues and to ensure that we're working together and working across government to try and address some of these critical challenges that we have that impact people across our islands. Because I think that, again, when it comes to when we look at the islands bond, when we look at all the other various bits of funding, we need to try and address all these issues, because I know that that's a critical point that comes out. You know, it's all very well trying to encourage people to come to islands or creating jobs, but we need to make sure that there's affordable housing to enable them to live there and to stay there and to become part of the community as well. So very cognizant of that, and like I say, we're taking that work forward across government, making sure our officials are working together as we look to develop policies in relation to that.
And Karen.
Sorry, I interfered with the mic. I shouldn't have touched it. My question was really in regards to food and drink, and to ask how does the Cabinet Secretaries and Ministers work together, possibly having a kind of helicopter oversight approach to food and drink, you know, from production to plate, particularly at the moment, you know, people are struggling, there is real food poverty, and how that portfolios interlink one with another, especially when we talk about food waste.
You're absolutely right. I mean, this affects food is an integral part of our lives. It affects so many different elements. There had previously been a ministerial working group on food, and that's something that we've set out in the cooperation agreement that we want to re-establish. And that would really bring together colleagues from across government to make sure that we're really addressing these issues as best we can. When I was Minister for Public Health at the start of the year, it's obviously an area that has a huge impact there too, because of dietary-related disease. It's impacted by poverty, so many different areas. So I think it's absolutely critical that we work across government to address some of the issues that we have. And that's also going to be key when we look to bringing forward the Good Food Nation Bill as well. And again, making sure that we're working across government and right across wider society in Scotland, and making sure that everybody has access to good food.
Thank you.
Thank you. And Beatrice.
Yeah, it's just a quick question. It's really just following on from the points Alistair Allen was making, and Karen had been making earlier about training and encouraging people to come into the food and drink workforce. But in terms of education and college education and lack of housing, there's actually a lack of student accommodation as well. So if we want to encourage people to come into the islands and learn, and make use of the excellent educational facilities that are there, then we need to do something about student accommodation too.
And again, I talked about the Rural Housing Action Plan that we'd be bringing forward, so happy to consider that and to look into that further.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. You touched on some policies you're going to bring forward for COP26. In relation to emissions reduction. Now, given that's only a few weeks away, can you? It would be natural to suggest that you will have some fairly well-formed ideas on how you're going to achieve these emission reductions in agriculture. Could you maybe lay out exactly what those policies might be? And can you rule out that will include a reduction in the production of red meat?
I'm happy to address those points. I mean, I addressed that a couple of times during the course of questions and during the debate last week when it comes to this notion of culling livestock. I mean, it's nonsense. It's nonsense last week, so it's nonsense this week. And that's not something that's being considered. In relation to the policies that are being developed, I mean, I don't think it's fair for me to prejudge the work of the Implementation Oversight Board. As I said at the start, our first meeting will be on Monday, and that will be for the board to discuss and to decide on. And you're right, COP isn't far away, and we want the group to be ambitious and, like I say, get to work and help and start delivering on emissions reductions. And I know that everybody that's on that board is keen to do that and to make that work happen and to progress it. So that's why the board is meeting fortnightly. That's really to keep the impetus and to keep the drive going so that we can develop that package of funded measures in time for COP.
I certainly wouldn't expect you to preempt the decisions or the recommendations of the board, but personally, as a Cabinet Secretary, do you have any suggestions on what those policies might be?
Well, again, I mean, the board was set up to drive forward the recommendations of the farmer-led groups. But alongside that, we've had various reports in the interim time as well. We've had Farming for 1.5. We've got to consider the climate change plan update, as well as various other reports that have been produced. So it's about, again, I can't just cherry pick off the top of my head without discussing with the board about, well, what are the ones that we can look to implement straight away. That'll be a discussion for the board to look at on consideration of the wider recommendations and to see what work can be progressed and what work can be progressed quickly.
Okay, thank you. And very lastly, Rachel.
Secretary, today was about this committee trying to take forward a work plan agenda, and you mentioned that the Bureau would be responsible for designating which Cabinet Secretary and which team, civil service team, would be taking forward the bills. So, I mean, we've already been delayed with the programme for government by a week. So do you know when the Bureau might be looking at this? Because surely it's something that you would like to know as well.
I mean, in relation to the committee consideration of the bill, that's what the Bureau would consider. But I think that's a question that's best placed for them as opposed to me.
Have you any indication as when you will know what you're responsible for?
Well, we already know, like I say, the Bureau decides which committee will consider the various pieces of legislation.
Okay, so, yeah, in that sense, could you then give us a list of which bills you will be taking forward?
I'll be happy to get back to the committee with more information on that, or who will be the lead on the various bits of legislation that are within the PFG.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. I very much appreciate the time taken today. Just to confirm, it's my understanding that the Deputy First Minister has confirmed the Scottish Government policy for home working and members officials to decide on a case-by-case basis whether they should attend committees, or indeed for members to attend the chamber. So given your desire to work along with the committee, can I ask why you didn't think it was important to appear in front of the committee today?
I was simply asked if I would be appearing virtually or not. It's not that I don't think it's important at all. And again, I know this will be the first meeting and first engagement of many that I'll have with the committee, and I look forward to working with committee members and will no doubt meet with you in person.
Okay, so that's a commitment to meet with us in person in the future?
Yes, of course.
Thank you very much. I really appreciate that. And I would like to thank you and your officials for answering the questions. We did run over a bit, but we really appreciate it. And we look forward to a constructive and a robust relationship over the next few years. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
We'll now move into private session. Thank you.